Today, we're taking a look at two diagrams that I created solely using Adobe Illustrator. Now, these diagrams are not only going to be really easy and simple to make, but they're very versatile in that you can use it for many different things like design, programming, concept ideas, timelines, and many more. Now, one of the great reasons for putting a diagram like this together is that it allows you to take something that would normally be done verbally or in a way that isn't all that captivating visually, to do so and take it and make this into a really captivating idea that can not only stand alone, but it can be something that you don't even need to be there to express that idea. So with that said, let's take a look at how to create some of those diagrams and what you can do to get started on them. What's going on, everybody? My name is Carter, and here we talk and teach about all things landscape architecture and urban design. So if that's of interest, be sure to check out my channel for tons of new content and content that exists on the subject. But that said, the things you're going to need to create a diagram like this are Illustrator and some vector images. Now, for those of you who don't know what a vector is or what they are, they're commonly referred to as an SVG file. Now, an SVG file just means that it is an image that is a scalable vector graphic. Now, why am I bringing up these vector images? Well, that's what Illustrator likes to work in the most, and what you'll find when you're working through it, that they are all SVG files. This is one of the most fundamental differences between Illustrator and, say, Adobe Photoshop. And that's because Illustrator likes to use graphic organizations like SVGs, whereas in Photoshop, you're using PNGs and JPEGs. So if you were to pull up the two side by side and draw a line or import an image, as you zoom in, you'll notice that on Photoshop, the image will start to get pixelated because Photoshop works primarily in pixels. Whereas if you were in Illustrator, as you zoom in, you can see that regardless of what you do, those images will always be nice and clean. Which is why Illustrator is the preferred option for most people who are doing graphic design and those sort of things, because down the road, if you need to scale it, shrink it, whatever you need to do, it's always gonna keep that nice attribute and clean edges. So to put a long story short, you wanna make sure that you're using vector images or finding some off the internet. And you can convert your own PNGs or JPEGs into an SVG as well. I'll put all the links to some of the free websites, paid websites, and ways you can transfer a JPEG or PNG in the description below. But there's a lot of great free options out there, and honestly, for landscape and what we're doing graphically, the free options are gonna be absolutely everything you're gonna need. But enough with that, let's take a look at how I created the first graphic. So head on over to Illustrator and create a new file in a format that you think is going to best represent what you wanna show. For today's purposes, I'm going to be showing it in an 11 by 17 format, which is a really common format to use for these type of things. So for this drawing, I decided to create a design strategy that will consist of four main themes that will end up as these kind of wavelengths that intertwine to show that these things are connected. But by doing the wavelength separately, it gives you the option to single out each strategy and see what lives on each individual wavelength. So what I'm doing to start off is I'm using the pen tool and drawing four straight lines that are equally spaced apart, and then I'm gonna duplicate it to add to the other side as our start and our finish line. Additionally, I've already went ahead and picked out a color palette that I plan on using here, and it's gonna help create a theme and organize the entire diagram and drawing here. Additionally here, it's a good idea to kind of give this a good width and a good amount of space as we're gonna be dropping some vectors over and along the wavelength as we go down the road. Once you have that all set, we're gonna use the curvature tool, and while holding shift, we're gonna click in some points randomly as we go across the page. Now make sure when you're doing this to make them really close together at the start and the finish. We're gonna wanna do this so that closer to the start and the end, that they keep kind of this nice straight or very low amount of curve to it. Then with the direct selection tool, we're going to click each wavelength and begin to stretch the anchors up and down to start making a wavelength. Make sure that when you're doing this, you're selecting the anchor, so that way it doesn't get all wonky on you and it gets very confusing if you're not selecting it from the point of origin, which is known as the anchor in Illustrator. So take your time on this and fine tune till you kind of find something that you like, and then you're gonna have the first part of this diagram done. It's a good idea to make sure that they're weaving together and that there's not too many curves to it. It's very gentle, very broad, but still has enough space to kind of add your vector graphics in. Next, we're gonna add some text that will correspond to each wavelength theme that we are using. For today, I'm gonna be using nature, access, program, and play. Then from here comes the fun part. Now we can start to drop in some of those vectors that we picked out and start to place them along our wavelength. The idea here is that they don't necessarily need to be a one-to-one exact replica of what we're going for. They just need to kind of show a general idea and a general theme to what we're going for to help prove and provide information on the concept or the drawing down the road. So begin to fill this out however you like, keep some good rhythm and spacing to it, and play around with the sizing till you start to kind of find a format that you can repeat and like. Then we're gonna repeat this process again with all of the other wavelengths. After doing a little bit more tweaking and rearranging, you're gonna end up with something that looks more or less like this. And remember, keep in mind that it doesn't need to be visually cluttered. We're just trying to convey the idea and the principle behind the theme or the idea behind each concept or in this diagram. Now the last step is really where it starts to come together, and what we're going to be doing is we're going to be adding some text to the bottom half of this graphic to start and tell a story of more of the specific things that are happening in your design. So write down some of your ideas that you're thinking of, or maybe you already have some ideas that you plan on using in your design. You want to write those down that kind of correlate to each category. Now to bring this graphic a little bit further together, I decided to give a nice skinny little rectangle that will be color oriented to where it is on the wavelength. And then when you're reading or looking through this graphic, you're going to understand this applies to that and this applies to this. You know, so some ideas here are things like habitat restoration, play amenities, community goals, whatever it is that you think is going to show up in your drawing down the line or already will show up in your drawings, include them here. The diagram will end up being a really great preview for what's to come in your project, especially in a presentation. And it's also a really great graphic to fall back on when you're trying to explain things in the beginning or either in the end during critic phases. But essentially, this is what that diagram could look like, and it's just one of the many different routes you could go with this specific graphic. You could very easily mimic this type of graphic for something like a timeline or site history. It's really easy to do in that way as well. So now let's try this diagram in a completely different way that has something similar, but is represented maybe in a different way with some different ideas. So for this one, I'm gonna go with something that can explain the main ideas to your project instead of the main themes that will show up in your project. So this one is going to be kind of a revolving circle that revolves around these four idea infographics. And the circle is gonna be kind of the origin or the creation of our design. But as they separate and leave the web, you know, we're trying to say that they're separate in their own way. And these are these different entities in your design. So to start, we are creating a small circle with the ellipse tool, which is located where the rectangle tool is, or if you can't find it, just hit L on the keyboard and it will bring that up. To make sure that it's a perfect circle, just be holding shift as you are creating your extents. Then we're gonna offset this a few times. To do this, head on over to the object and then select path and then select offset path. Then with the amount selected, scroll on your mouse and you can see as you move it, the offset will decrease or increase. In our case, we're gonna be doing this a few different times and we're gonna wanna increase the amount of the offset by a little bit each time we do this. So that way at the end of this, we're gonna have four visible rings. If you're not seeing any rings, then just make sure that your stroke is on. And in our case, it's gonna be on white with a width of somewhere around 2 points. Once you have that all squared away, you're gonna wanna use the pen tool and we're gonna be making a line to the horizontal and the vertical of our object, so it will end up looking kind of like a bullseye. Then we're gonna click and drag to select the entire object, and then head on over to the Shape Builder tool. This is gonna be a really versatile tool in Illustrator. It kind of deserves its own video in its own right, but it essentially allows you to kind of separate ideas and shapes and also delete them as well. Now in our case, the reason why we drew those two lines overlapped through the entire circle is so that we could delete the top right edge here. So if you notice, as you hold Alt, your cursor will have a minus sign next to it. You can then click on it and then fill in the shape and it will delete it out. So once you have that done, you're gonna end up with a 3/4 pie shape and you'll be ready to move on to the next step. Next, we're gonna turn this smallest circle here back to white, and then we're gonna use the pen tool and draw in some thin lines to designate different part of those idea arcs. Our first line is gonna go to the end of the circle, and then we're gonna follow up each additional line going to the smaller circle until we are finished. Next, we're gonna add some small circle callouts that are gonna have a corresponding color that will relate to our design idea in the infographic. Then we're gonna create a guide for the arrays by offsetting our interior circle to where those points lie on that diagram. Then it gets a little bit tricky, but we're gonna trace around that circle so we have the first part of the array. So like I said, we're gonna repeat this process for all the different callouts, and then we'll have a circle that is starting to look like this. Then we're gonna make some larger circles on the right side of the page that will be the end line to that array on the left, and we'll connect it with some text. So under that main line that connects back to the array, we're gonna type in a little bit of text to help guide what the infographic is and what it's about. And then additionally, in the arrays, we're gonna add some text that support the sub ideas to the main infographic or the main part of your design. So for the text in the arrays, we wanna make sure that we're selecting all of our paths we drew first and copying and pasting them in place. Then we're gonna select the type in path tool, which is part of the text toolbar, and then we can add in our supporting ideas. We can flip the text orientation by going to type, type on path, click type on path options, and then we can click flip icon. Lastly, all that's gonna be left to do here is to bring in some vectors and make some little infographics that will tie back to your main ideas. Additionally here, if you wanted to, you could drop in some of your concepts that you've been working on or something along those lines that pertains to your design. But for me, I'm gonna be going with kind of a collage style that will sort of represent or allude to some of my ideas. So I'm really just kind of playing around with the vectors that I have. I'm moving things around. I'm changing the scale and the size of things to try and give an idea to what the main thing about this infographic is that pertains back to the idea. So kind of as I'm going through and doing this, I'm thinking about, you know, what are the key elements to each idea? And I'm trying to make them be the focus, or, you know, maybe they have an abundance or they're larger so that they're shown as more important in that smaller infographic. So kind of play around with this, a little bit of trial and error, but once you kind of find a style that you like and are excited about, repeat this process and you'll end up looking like this. The last thing we need to do to complete this diagram is to just finish connecting the lines so that we have our final bridge between the infographics and the arrays. So like I said before, I think these two diagrams are really versatile. They can be used in a couple different ways, and I really like the way they came out. I could definitely see myself, if I was in school, as using these towards the beginning of a project for explaining some key ideas for a concept, or maybe some site analysis or a timeline. I think they're really great options for that, and are a really nice kind of title slide image just to showcase what's to come in your drawings. But of course, there's lots of other interpretations to take from these designs too. So if any of you guys go through and try to make some of these diagrams and delve away from what we did today, be sure to share me that on Instagram. I'd love to see some of your guys' creations and share it out as well. But that's gonna be it for today's video. So comment below which specific diagram you liked more, and if you had any questions on how to create a diagram like this. And be sure to do all those normal YouTube things, like the video, share with a friend who needs to do a diagram like this. I really appreciate the support and it helps get this out to others. And if you're looking for some more great landscape architecture content, then be sure to check out my channel for more. But thank you guys for hanging out today, and I will see you in the next video. Peace.